of Sorelle Friedler as our speaker today. So Sorelle is an associate professor of computer science at Haverford College. And as you may have just overheard, Haverford is a fantastic institution which trains undergraduates to do independent research and produced our own Aaron Clausette and several other wonderful people I know. So if you should check it out. She's also an affiliate at the Data and Society Research Institute, and she's really played a central role in the community of computer scientists that are trying to wrestle with fairness and accountability and transparency in all of these high stakes algorithmic decisions affecting our lives. And she's written many of my favorite papers in the area. So without further ado, she's going to talk to us about fairness in networks. And I'm very much hoping that whenever she feels comfortable and has good reason to feel comfortable, she will also visit us physically in Santa Fe. So Sorelle, you have an open invitation.
Thank you.
Whenever time and virus will allow.
Yeah, and I'm gonna talk about two papers today. We'll see how much I make it through in the time, but feel free to just sort of, raise your hand or whatever when you want to jump in with a question, or we can hold them to the end, whatever you all would like to do.
Oh, and by the way, our local culture is that you have, as the speaker, no responsibility to follow the chat.
I won't.
good. If I see something really important, then I elevate it, but otherwise.
Okay, good. Please do. anyway, it's nice to be invited. So like I said, I want to sort of talk about two papers. One is sort of like more on the theory end and then sort of moving towards the experimental. And overall, this work and most of the work that I do these days is motivated by this idea of artificial intelligence or, machine learning and the societal and ethical implications, which has, risen to the level of congressional hearings and lots of attention in the media. And usually when we're talking about these problems, we're often framing them as fairness in decision-making, where often there's some classification task and we're modeling that with some machine learning function. And we have some given data that consists of protected and unprotected attributes, right? Where protected attributes might be race or gender. And the idea is that these protected attributes are intrinsic to the individual, and you want to try to guarantee fairness with respect to those attributes. But this work is really motivated by the question of what do you do when you're thinking about that in terms of a social network, right? So now you have nodes who are people, but additionally, you have the network itself. And the question is essentially, how does that play into our understanding of fairness? And this is really motivated by the idea of social capital, right? So there's a longstanding understanding that your position in a social network is a form of power, right? And it's that class marker is defined by the network, right? Not by the individual node, right? But right by that person's position in the overall network. And there's a beautiful paper by Boyd, Levy, and Marwick that lays out the concern of what happens when you look at something like a social network, and now you are potentially automating decisions on top of that network. And what would it mean to have discrimination, automated discrimination, based on network position? So some examples of this, right? If you imagine that there's information, such as the knowledge of a job posting flowing across that network, say the network is LinkedIn, then who has access to jobs is determined by their social network position, right? By that social capital in the network, and could be discriminatory based on that position. That's where you would like the information, but what about if you don't want someone to have information about you, right? We also see concerns about surveillance. There are sort of police mechanisms that try to use people's social networks to try to surveil them. there's also access to social credit, right? The sort of well-known example of that is the Chinese social credit system. But we in the US are also doing this, especially with CBP and ICE. And then especially relevant right now, there's also questions about access to public health information, right? Who hears about access to COVID vaccine slots? Who hears about the misinformation about COVID vaccines, right? Who's receiving good public health information or bad public health information? And all of these are really determined by your position in the social network. For the purposes of this work, I'm gonna think about the good version of receiving information. So this is sort of more the jobs version where you would like to receive the information, right? And so your position in the social network would ideally allow you to receive information about jobs you might be interested in. And again, sort of going back to the sociology literature, we know that this network position confers advantage. And in an automated system, we also know that these social networks can grow through recommendations, right? Automated recommendations, as well as organically. And how do we think about sort of what the biased input data is, right? So in a sort of more traditional classifier decision-making setting, we often think about some of the bias to the ultimate decisions coming from the data. And so then the question here might be, where is this biased input data? And essentially we're sort of positing that comes out of the edges in the social network, right? So who you know sort of makes up the bias inherent in the social network data. So these types of questions are often framed based on influence maximization. So the sort of classic problem to think about here is suppose that you have a graph and you have some mechanism for spreading information across the graph. This is often framed in an advertising setting, right? So you're gonna buy ads to show to people. And you have K seeds, so that's K people in the network who you can seed the information to. Then the question is, based on sort of how the information spreads through the network, how many nodes can you end up influencing across the network? So you might imagine that these sort of lighter colored nodes are our seed nodes, and that they share information with the people they know. And maybe those people share information with people they know, right? And then you end up with this group of people who have the information and could potentially be influenced by it. That's sort of the general problem setup. Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt. I just going back a slide, I guess I want to clarify what you mean by discrimination. So are you thinking about this sort of social network position as correlated with individual characteristics that are sort of legally covered as discriminatory classes? Or are you thinking about social network position itself being something on which to discriminate? And then how does that relate to, we know that, you know, there's so much sociological evidence that even without algorithms, there's a ton of discrimination based on social position. So what does having these algorithms do on top of that? Or you know, I guess you sort of understand what I mean.
Yeah, so those are all sort of the, I would say those are all the big questions, right? That we're sort of like trying to figure out how to approach. And so you'll sort of see that we try to approach those in a couple of different ways, right? So I guess like I'll come back to that question in the specifics, right? In the like, you know, mathematically, like how am I thinking about this? But overall, like I think the answer is in all of these ways, right? I'm interested in it and I care about it. Yeah. And I guess that's sort of as much as I'll say for now.
Sounds good. Thanks.
Okay. So I'm going to sort of start with this this first paper where we're sort of trying to say, okay, you know, given this problem, right, how do we start to take this bigger idea, right, about discrimination and social networks and figure out what a more mathematical notion of fairness might be within this context. And we're going to think about that in terms of access gaps, which I'm going to define in a minute, and thinking about how do we intervene. We're going to think about, okay, who gets those initial seeded pieces of information, and can we potentially redistribute that in some way to make it fair? In order to get to there, we need some mechanism for spreading information, right? So there's a bunch of different mechanisms that we could choose. I'm going to focus on the information cascade mechanism, which for those of you who've become interested in epidemiological models is also thought of as SIR under that context. So the idea is that you have an active node, right? That's potentially a node that you've seeded with the information, and then they have a possibility based on some probability alpha of sending that information along to any of their neighbors, right? So some of their neighbors will receive the information and some of them won't. And then after they send the information, they become inactive, okay? Or recovered in the SIR version. So that's sort of the basic idea. And then our question was, okay, what possible welfare definitions could we consider, right? Based on sort of the individual probability that any node receives the information that you're trying to spread, right? So we could look at, okay, what's the expected number of nodes that we might reach? We could look at what is the sort of mean probability that a node receives that information. We could look at what's the minimum probability over all nodes that they receive that information. I'm sure there's a bunch of other things that we could all think of. But ultimately, what our overall problem goal is to figure out, okay, who do I add information to, right? Who do I additionally give the information to so that whatever welfare function we decide on, we manage to maximize that welfare function, right? And then obviously the question is, which welfare function makes sense, right? And when I say makes sense here, I mean normatively in terms of capturing what we care about in terms of discrimination. So that led us to the next question, which was, what do we care about? And we had to take a few stabs at this. So one sort of version of this is, okay, maybe we care about the access gap, right? It seems like there's going to be some people who are sort of privileged in the network and some people who are not privileged in the network. And we care about the differential between those two groups of nodes. And we want it to be as small as possible. And what's more, we want to make sure that our interventions where we add in more seed nodes don't make the rich get richer, right? We want to make sure that sort of at least we're not making things worse, right? By giving more people information. And in fact, ideally, we'd want to close that gap, right? So that's sort of our initial thought. Okay, maybe this makes sense normatively as a definition that we could consider. Unfortunately, it turns out it's not possible, right? This is often the case, but it turns out that it's not actually possible to do this. And I think the sort of intuition is best captured by this graph, right? So suppose that that grayed out node is your initial seed node, and then you have a budget of one more seed node to add, right? The optimal place to add that seed node is V2. But if these are your partitions, the sort of gray circles, if those are your partitions, then obviously adding the information to V2 even further increases that rich partition, but it's also the only way to get the information to the other partition, right? So essentially some graphs may sort of disallow this normative notion that we'd like, right? We'd like to be able to guarantee this, but it's not really possible. We then said, okay.
I see, and just to understand the example, the problem here is that V3 and V4 are not connected to each other. So they're sort of atomized and are at the mercy of V1 and V2 to get the information.
Yeah, exactly. And for what it's worth, I also think that that's not even a particularly pathological example, right? Because often in social networks, we see that there's sort of, you know, outliers on the periphery, right? Who rely on sort of a rich core of people to get their information. And what this is sort of saying is like, you'd need to give those people in that rich core even more information, unless you have the budget to go seek out each one of those individual people on the periphery, right? Which you probably don't. So that was disappointing. And then we thought, okay, you know, is there some version of this, right, that we can salvage here? Is there like some worst case version of keeping, of the rich getting richer? And here we might say, well, if the rich get richer, but at least that disadvantaged group, right, their access comes up, right, but then at least we've improved it somewhat, right? Because certainly you could design interventions where that doesn't even happen. So this seems like a sort of a weaker notion. Can we at least satisfy that, right? And it turns out, no, we can't even satisfy that for the max reach or the mean versions of the welfare function. But we can satisfy that for this minimax notion, right? Where our welfare function goal is to maximize the minimum probability that anyone receives the information, right? And the basic idea there, I actually also think is normatively valuable, right? It's this idea that by trying to maximize this minimum probability, you're gonna be forced to do outreach to the people who are most disadvantaged in terms of their information access, right? It's essentially a notion that forces you to find the people with the least access to information and try to raise them up, which I also actually think is normatively a reasonable notion of fairness, right? It turns out still finding the best intervention is NP hard, but that was, I guess, always going to be the case. So that sort of leads us to a notion of individual fairness in networks, right? Where you say, okay, an individual's information, access is measured by that probability that they receive the information. And so you can look at sort of disadvantage across groups in terms of this access gap. And you can avoid these sort of worst case risk, rich get richer phenomena by focusing on maximizing that minimum probability, right? Okay, so how can we do this, right, is the next question. And for this, right, because it's an NP-hard problem, we're obviously just focusing on heuristics. And we considered sort of, I guess, what I would think of as the basic starting point for the heuristics, right? So where would we start? With a greedy notion that essentially says, okay, let's try to estimate the probabilities that every individual will receive that information, right? Pick the individual with the sort of who giving them the information, right, will most maximize that minimum probability, re-estimate all of the probabilities, right, and then pick the next seed based on that individual who's going to maximize that. The problem here is that estimating the probabilities is really expensive. It requires these Monte Carlo simulations that take a while. So we want to, as much as possible, sort of remove that step, or at least sort of like move it one level up in terms of our nested loops. So we looked at a myopic version that says, okay, what about if I estimate the probability and then I, instead of trying to figure out how that's going to sort of propagate out to all of the other nodes, what if instead I just say, okay, I'm gonna find the vertex with the lowest probability and I'm just gonna give them the information, right? So that's sort of a myopic version of it. We also considered the version, so this myopic version still requires you to do K minus one estimated probability loops. That's still somewhat expensive. What if instead we just do the naive version where we estimate the probability of everyone receiving information? We pick the K people who have the smallest probability of receiving the information and then distribute the information to everyone, right? And then finally, what if we didn't want to estimate probabilities at all? Maybe we could just pick people who are far away from each other. We're sort of calling this Gonzalez after the Gonzalez K-center algorithm that also essentially proceeds in this way, right? You try to sort of distribute the centers, in that case, in this case, the seeded information, so that people are far away from each other in the network in hopes that you sort of distribute the information across the network. Okay, so that's sort of the basic ideas of some of the strategies we're going to try. We also wanted to see if this was different than if we were looking at max reach, right? So max reach is a pretty, one of the sort of pretty standard information access algorithms, or goals, I should say, because it's based on managing to reach as many people as possible, often with advertisements. And so the main way that this, these algorithms have sort of different impacts than that is in the people who have low probability of receiving the information. Right, so this is just a histogram based on the nodes in the graph of how much information people could receive. And you can see sort of on that low probability end, what these types of algorithms are gonna do is sort of target those people who have a low probability of receiving the information. And it's gonna bring that count way down. And overall, you know, across a bunch of different data sets, we find that actually even these versions, the myopic and the naive myopic versions that do many fewer probability estimates still perform pretty well. And what you see here is on the y-axis, it's that min access probability, right? It's looking at that minimum access probability across all of the nodes in the graph. And what we want to see is that that goes up, right? We raise everybody's access to information. And indeed, they managed to do that. Okay, but I think this really begs some of the questions that were asked sort of at the beginning of the talk, right? In that this is very much an individual notion, right? It's looking at all of the individuals, and it doesn't really tell us about network position disadvantage overall. Right? It sort of says, with respect to these particular seed nodes that you've chosen, right, these people have these probabilities of receiving access. But what we were really interested in is can we figure out what that next step is, right? Is there some way to consider a network and try to understand overall what people's position in that network says, right? To potentially even group people based on their position in the network. So that was sort of what we looked at next in the, you know, COVID Zoom era. And what we were trying to figure out, right, is building on this notion that information access is a good, right, is something that we would like to see distributed. Can we understand people's position in a social network based on their information access to all of the other nodes? And in order to do this, we're going to build up just a little bit more infrastructure. So I want to give you sort of some intuition before I dive into the definitions too much. So consider these two graphs, right? We've got a star graph that has a central node and lots of peripheral nodes. And then we have a three communities graph, right? Where in each of those different colored blobs, you should imagine that there's lots and lots of edges connecting up, say, all of the members of the red community to other members of the red community. And the same is true within yellow, and the same is true within blue, right? How would we want these nodes to be clustered if we were clustering it based on information access? In other words, part of the question we were asking ourselves is how would we think about groups in these networks in terms of groups of people who sort of naturally know the same information or have similar access to resources like jobs? And essentially what we thought sort of made sense normatively is colored in those graphs, right? So we sort of think about the central node in the star graph as being distinct from the peripheral nodes in terms of its access to information, right? It's the hub and it sort of controls all the information. And then the peripheral nodes are all really indistinguishable from each other, right? They have the same connectivity in the network. On the other hand, this community structure, we think about, well, everyone in the red community sort of has access to the same information, right? They all talk to each other. It's a very tight-knit community. And that is somehow distinct from the yellow community and the blue community. So that's sort of the hypothesis that we started off with.
So why wouldn't all the peripheral nodes in the star network be different colored according to the intuition?
So they could be, I guess, if you wanted to sort of drive the number of clusters up to n, right? That's a fair way of thinking about it. We were sort of thinking about, okay, well, what if k equals 2? Yeah, and I guess similarly for the three communities version, the sort of implied K is three, right? Okay, so building off of that previous work, right, where we were thinking about that probability that an individual receives information from anywhere else in the network, we then said, okay, well, what about if we consider the probability that a node receives information from another specific node? Right? And we do that for each of the n nodes in the graph. Then for each person, right, there's going to be a vector of probability of size n that says what their probability is of receiving nodes from everyone else in the network. So we're going to call that our information access signature, right? The idea being that it's sort of a signature vector that tells you how likely you are to receive information from each different person. And part of the idea there is that we think about in a social network that sort of each person is their own individual information source, right? So this is different than the previous problem where we imagined that there was, say, one job and you were sort of seeding it at a bunch of different nodes. Here we're imagining that each person is sort of generating their own news content or their own sort of access to jobs at the company they work at, right? So we have this vector. And then obviously what we can do with that is we can put that into a matrix, right? And so now we have a full representation for the network of what it looks like in terms of information access from every node to every other node, right? What are all of those different probabilities? And then based on that, doing out an example here just to make sure we're all on the same page. If we go back to that star network, right? Then what we can think about is that central node, which here I'm denoting as A, is going to have a probability of one of receiving any information it has, right? And then it's going to have a probability of alpha, where alpha is our transmission probability under an independent cascade model. It's going to have a probability of alpha of receiving any information from any of the other nodes, right? All the periphery nodes are going to have a probability of alpha of receiving information from the central node, right? But then a probability of alpha squared of receiving information from any of the other peripheral nodes, right? So you end up with a matrix that looks like that. Okay, so then what we can obviously do is we can think about each of these vectors as essentially existing in an n-dimensional space, right? And we can cluster them. In this case, we just used the normal L2 distance and k means, right? And if we do that, then with the information access clustering and k equals two, we do end up with the star graph sort of being clustered so that those peripheral nodes are all clustered together and the central node is separate. On the other hand, for something like spectral clustering that relies more on connectivity, that sort of expects nodes in a single cluster to be somehow connected to each other if possible, you end up with something that looks pretty different. And on the communities version, right, you'll similarly, for information access clustering, you'll end up with those three distinct clusters that we had been sort of hoping to get. I think this then, you know, begs the question, right? Like, okay, so you've made this representation. You started off by talking about discrimination. Can you actually connect the two, right? Do these actually relate to each other? Does this tell us anything interesting? Or is it just an arbitrary graph clustering method, right? And in order to try to figure this out, what we looked for were network data sets where it made sense to think about information as flowing across the network. And also where we had access to some sort of node attribute that you could reasonably think about as indicating an external measure of information access, right? We sort of wanted an external marker of like, which ones are the privileged nodes and which ones are the less privileged nodes. And we wanted that to not be something that's encoded in the network. So we were purposefully looking for data sets where that measure was not like node degree or something that's sort of obviously part of the network, but was some sort of external yardstick as much as possible. And then our goal was to see, okay, if we do this clustering, right, do we naturally end up with clusters where the distributions in terms of that external measure are different for different clusters, right? Where we could think about those clusters as sort of being clustered, you know, the people who are privileged with respect to that measure versus not. So that was sort of our goal in collecting data sets. And we ended up with these four data sets. Two of them are co-authorship networks, where the sort of external measure was citations or H-index. And then we used the Twitch follower network, where there's this, there's a number of views, but there's also this partner measure, which is sort of like whether Twitch has declared them to have partner status. And then a co-sponsorship network, which is about co-sponsorship of bills in Congress. And there's a external legislative effectiveness score that's used to sort of rank our Congress people. So those were sort of our data sets and our external measures. And we then ran statistical tests to determine, you know, if you look at our clustering, right, can you distinguish the marginal distributions based on those external measures, right? So if you look at the distribution of that external measure for each cluster, are they different, right? Do those distributions look different across different clusters? Have we sort of effectively separated out the people who are privileged in this respect versus not? And across the board, the information access clustering was able to do that. We also looked at a bunch of different other clustering methods, spectral clustering, but also two community clustering methods, one sort of role clustering method and a core periphery method. And what was really interesting is that some of those were also able to sort of separate out some of the clusters, some of the data sets, but not others of the data sets. So the core periphery one sort of had pretty similar results for both the DBLP, this co-authorship network, and the Twitch network, but looked a bit different on the co-sponsorship network. And the community detection ones were sort of reversed a bit. They looked more similar on the co-sponsorship and less similar on the other ones. And so our hypothesis there is that, you know, you can think about the core periphery ones as being sort of like that star graph, right? And and sort of wanting a network that looks like that star graph to operate on. And you can think about the community detection one as sort of expecting a network that looks sort of more like the three communities one. And most of these other clustering methods are sort of designed to work on one type of network or the other, but maybe not on both, right? Whereas the information access clustering was able to work across both. There's a piece of important information that I've sort of swept under the rug so far in describing these experiments, which is alpha, right? Which is really a network dependent decision. Ideally, this would be a domain decision about how the information actually flows across the network. We don't have information actually about what the probability is, for example, that two co-authors share information about a paper, right? But this is what that alpha would be trying to capture. And so instead, what we did for the experiments was looked at a range of alpha values and looked at what happened to these sort of the histogram of probabilities across the network. Because what you would expect is if you have a really small alpha value, then you're going to end up with the probability of everyone receiving information essentially zero from all other nodes, right? Because there's just such a low probability of information flow. And if you have a really high alpha value, then you're going to end up with essentially all of the probabilities are one, meaning essentially everybody has access to the information. And so neither of those are particularly interesting in terms of creating an interesting representation of the information access that you could then cluster. So what we tried to do was sort of figure out, okay, what are the range of alpha values where some people have access to the information and some people don't, right? And then let's consider the clustering across that range. And we were also interested to know, you know, does the clustering end up changing a lot from alpha to alpha, or is there some consistency there? And from what we could tell, it looks like there's sort of there's some sort of smooth transition, right? So it's not consistent across the entire range of alpha values. But what you could see in that chart on the right is the sort of bright yellow parts are the parts where across those alpha values, the clusterings we ended up with were mostly the same, right? Whereas the dark colors, the clusterings were mostly different. So there were a few other things. I wasn't sure I'd have time, but I think maybe I have a few more minutes. So I'll sort of share one more set of results with you, which is that one of the other things that we were curious about is, you know, what do these clusterings look like, right? Why is it that in some cases they are more like these community detection methods, and in some cases it's more like the core periphery methods? And so we went ahead and looked at the number of connected components in each cluster. And so actually for all of these data sets, we ran it for k=2. And we found that the information access clustering made for the DBLP and Twitch data sets made one large connected component for one cluster. And then the other cluster was a bunch of different disconnected components, which is also what the core periphery method did, right? Whereas for the co-sponsorship data, it made two both connected components, right? As did the community detection methods, which we also thought sort of gave us some insight into what was really going on behind the scenes. I think there are still some questions for me about to what extent these really serve. So to what extent are these clusters that come out of this clustering societally legible, right? You know, we know obviously that in networks, we expect to see a lot of homophily in terms of how people are connected. Does that actually also appear in these clusters, right? And to what extent is something else appearing? I think it would still be really interesting to do sort of more of a deep dive into a single data set and better understand what we're finding and to what extent that's societally relevant. This also obviously doesn't address some of the questions I raised at the beginning about, you know, what about groups who want to avoid surveillance, right? This, you know, I've been thinking mostly about how do you spread access to information? But there's sort of an interesting reverse question about, you know, how do you allow people to avoid it? And I think that's where I'll close. Thanks.
We have plenty of time for questions.
Great.
I'll ask one while people warm up their questions. So the in a tree, in the particular information spreading model you described, then, you know, it's this matrix is alpha raised to the length of the path, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if you summed over all paths and assumed that they were independent, then you would have a geometric series in the adjacency matrix, which is the same as what the inverse of the identity minus alpha times the adjacency matrix. So I'm wondering if that would give similar results for some fairly broad set of information spreading mechanisms. And it also reminds me of these electrical distances, right? Where each edge has a resistance and you invert the graph Laplacian and basically ask what would the voltage drop be from this node to that node? So I guess offline, I can mention some other notions of quote community detection that try to be flexible about whether it's core periphery or assortative or disassortative or whatever. But anyway, I think this question of fast approximations, even heuristic ones, to computing this matrix is very interesting, obviously, to epidemiologists who, you know, are dealing with large dense graphs now, especially from human mobility data, where they really don't have the time to do all the Monte Carlo experiments to try to figure out which intervention would be best.
Yeah, so one thing that, there's a lot there, but let me respond to that last bit. One thing that we did try, so the Google Scholar data that I just sort of mentioned in passing was quite large. So you can see the actual numbers of nodes and edges there. And what we did for that was actually not compute the entire matrix of probabilities, but we looked at what happened if you sort of randomly choose a couple of nodes to consider the probability from, mm-hmm. right? So you still sort of end up with as many rows as there are nodes in the network, right? But you don't necessarily need to compute the probabilities from every single other node in the network in order to create that information access vector. You can actually just use a smaller sample of those nodes. And we looked at what happened under like different selection strategies for how you choose that smaller sample in terms of what the resulting cluster is. So we did that on one of the smaller networks on the DBLP network. And we found that if you wanted to go ahead and compute some of the common centrality notions, right, between the centrality and so on, and you wanted to choose just the top number of nodes based on that centrality measure, then you got a very good approximation very quickly of what the overall clustering would have been. But computing those notions is also expensive. It turns out also if you just randomly choose a bunch of nodes, you have to have some more nodes, but not actually that many more. We ended up, mostly as a heuristic, using square root of n nodes to compute that. And that worked pretty well on the graphs we tried. It got us pretty close to the same clustering that we would have gotten had we fully computed the vector.
So it's a kind of low rank approximation in a way.
Exactly.
And these are undirected graphs. So if I'm central, I'm also likely to get infected.
So they were not all undirected graphs.
Okay.
So the co-sponsorship network, I'm pretty sure is directed. And then Twitch, I think, was also directed. And then the co-authorship networks are undirected.
More questions? I mean, I think it's... This is also, there's this universe of problems to look at here that are range from the theoretical to the societal.
Yeah, and this is absolutely sort of initial work in this area, right? Like we absolutely see it that way. There have been some other groups who have worked on, what happens if you use demographic characteristics on a network, right? So you attach the understanding of race to each individual node in the network. And then you sort of look at notions of fair information access, but across those groups, right? So that's, certainly another problem to look at. But yeah, I'm sort of interested in this area, right? Because I think that there are a lot of really important questions here that I think haven't been really examined much at all yet. Most of the work in this area goes back to just about 2018, 2019, right? So there's sort of a smallish collection of papers at this point.
Yeah, I guess I'm thinking about this in relation to demographic characteristics, and also, like, ideally, would I, coming from a more economic sociology background, I'd love to see how this applies to some of the settings you talked about right in the beginning, where it's like credit, access to credit, or jobs and so on. But in a lot of those situations, your access to information is not purely a function of your social network, but also demographic characteristics, to the extent that, say, LinkedIn has all that information about you and will target you separately. And so being able to kind of disentangle the, how much is pure demographic or individual level characteristics is how much is purely social network and social position driven. I mean, I don't even know if it makes sense to separate them, because it's like, well, one leads to the other and so on. I don't really have a question there, but.
No, I mean, I think that's fascinating, right? We've been sort of purposefully looking at, what can you know about someone knowing only the network, right? Because I think it's sort of fascinating to understand that these notions, these sort of external notions, as we sort of showed, they're maybe less external than we might think. These external notions appear in the graph just based on the network structure, right? But you're absolutely right. In most real world applications, you would also have all of the node attribute information. It's interesting to think about whether you could do a study to sort of say, you know, we can attribute this amount of discrimination to the network position and this amount to the additional node characteristics. I agree, it would be really, really tough to sort of disentangle that.
I was sort of thinking about like the academic co-authorships are sort of we know intuitively that, you know, social networks matter so much for resources and so on in academia, but in some ways the co-authorship network is the result of that underlying social network. And so trying to have this sort of clustering measure for the underlying, you know, causal network would be, you know, ideal, because we seem to refer to it, you know, as lay folks all the time. Oh yeah, you're at a prestigious place, or you're at a, you know, you're well connected, or so on and so forth. But where does that actually come from?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I mean, I have, I actually have a student sort of trying to think about, you know, if there's anything that we can say there right now, right? And we're still, you know, only in the initial stages of that. But, you know, I think part of the question there is, if, for example, if you looked at somebody's social network in, or academic, you know, co-authorship network as of grad school, right? Could you anticipate where they might end up at a job? Or even if you can't do that perfectly, can you sort of understand some of the mechanisms that might have landed them there? And yeah, it seems intuitively like you might be able to, but also sort of hard to pin down.
I guess the current narrative about vaccine hesitancy is that we have different communities, you know, religious, racial, and so on, that each community has central nodes and peripheral nodes, and that we need to convince the central nodes in each community. But then there's this additional issue of, you know, if there's more distrust and the nodes are, if those edges have lower transmissibility, as it were, or the nodes have lower susceptibility, as it were, then we have to pump more resources into the central nodes of those communities. And then I guess there's this also, you know, then there's this complication that in many of these vaccine hesitant communities, a lot of the links are offline as opposed to online. So it's a kind of different, it requires a larger commitment of literally time and also sort of social knowledge.
I mean, I think that there's also a couple of interesting, more abstract technical questions that you raise there, right? Like there's definitely the societal question. But one of the things that we've assumed in this work, right, is we've assumed the information cascade model. And what's more, we've assumed a single parameter alpha for the transmission probability across an edge. But we of course know that transmission probability is not necessarily equal between all individuals, right? And so what would it mean to sort of more fully model that? Say even by distinguishing three different types of alpha, right? Like maybe you don't need to go to sort of n squared different alpha between all different possible pairs, right? But maybe there's sort of natural sort of between group versus within group expression and transmission probability. I think that would be really, really interesting to understand better. And I think also part of what you're pointing to, or at least what I always think about when thinking about sort of vaccine hesitancy, is then of course interventions, right? What are the appropriate interventions to sort of try to change the broad understanding of knowledge within these communities? And, you know, so I think, you know, in some of this work, right, I've been talking about sort of seeded information at different nodes. You can also think about adding edges, right? Maybe you sort of, you know, convince two people to be friends, and that sort of opens up different mechanisms for transmission. And so I'm curious to understand better, you know, what those mechanisms are and how much, if at all, they translate into these sort of real societal problems.
Yeah, I was talking with an epidemiologist who was reflecting on the fact that some proposed interventions, including like vaccination is a node-based intervention, but many of the proposed behavioral non-pharmaceutical interventions are more about edges and, you know, in that case, trying to cut them or reduce their weight. I want to make sure anybody else has an opportunity to ask questions. I have one more. So, I mean, I think the other, like you, I'm sure you know this, but like in a lot of these community detection methods, especially the ones that are agnostic about whether it's core periphery or assortative or homophilic or whatever, like in the classic karate club network, if you ask those, a lot of those methods to divide the world into two groups, they don't divide it into the two communities we expect. Instead, they divide it into the core and the periphery. And so, you know, they say, well, actually what matters the most in, from their point of view is whether you're central and of high degree or peripheral and of low degree. And then you have to kind of push it around a little bit, changing its objective function to get it to say, oh, okay, I see there are two factions, each of which has a core and periphery. And I think this is interesting philosophically because we have these specific protected attributes that our society and our barely functioning legislative branch has managed to call out, right? Race, gender, and so on. But then there are all these other axes that are not orthogonal to these, but not the same. Of course, the big one in our society is class. And then also in this case is it is centrality, which I suppose is strongly correlated with age and things like that. And I don't think anyone has any language to talk about in our political discourse. How do we avoid discriminating against peripheral people or poorly connected people? The only way we talk about that is pointing out that all forms of power are connected to a lot of these protected characteristics and then trying to address that. And then you have, yeah, I mean, in a very vague sense, it seems analogous to the fact that we, you know, we're thinking a lot right now about like a lot of university departments pat themselves in the back for diverse hires when they're hiring, in some cases, the elite members of that protected class and not reaching into the non-elite members that are, you know, so this is, it's very thorny.
Yeah, so I mean, this is actually part of what you're pointing to is some of the genesis of this work, right? So part of, I would say, the seed for some of these ideas was planted from a conversation that my co-authors and I had with Dana Boyd, who's also a co-author on our first paper that I just discussed, back after the 2016 election. And we were sort of talking about, you know, why were the polls so wrong, right? And she said, well, you know, one thing that you need to consider, right, is that most of these polls are sort of weighted by demographic characteristic. So you look at, say, a 20-something white man in Philadelphia, where I live, versus a 20-something white man in Altoona, where Dana is originally from. And they're going to have very different access to opportunities. Right? Their networks are going to look very different. Their job access is going to look very different. But a poll might sort of look at them and say, oh, those two people are in the same demographic bucket, right? And so we were sort of thinking, you know, how do you capture these more nuanced notions of community and of identity in a way that better allows you to understand how people experience information? Yeah, so that's what we were trying to do here. You know, I think there's obviously still sort of a long way to go and a lot of things to think about there. But yeah, you're pointing to exactly some of our motivation.
Anjali, do you want to add anything?
No, that was just such an interesting point because now I'm thinking about, okay, if we think about this as like a sort of a way of stratifying differently or additively stratifying populations, what can we do with that? And I'm just sort of playing that out in my head.
Yeah, and I would also love to know the answer to that, but you know, haven't investigated it.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess the idea of intersectionality is to start looking at Boolean combinations of all these things, but I think that partly gets to it, but not entirely.
I mean, I think the broader idea of intersectionality really is a call to think about power, right? And so I think, you know, part of what we're trying to get at here is where is power in a social network, right? And we're sort of claiming that that's access, which I think is true in some scenarios and not true in others.
Yeah, I guess I was starting to think about if there's a way to, you know, you had talked about like alpha is very network specific, but also the meaning of information access is very network specific. And I guess I'm just wondering if there's a way to jointly model two completely different, like, you know, if you're going to talk about the welfare of a network, can you incorporate both the information access and the surveillance together?
Interesting. Yeah, I don't know. I haven't honestly thought as much about the surveillance side of it yet. And specifically what I don't yet understand is, so I suspect that it is not simply, well, let's look at, you know, the minimum access to the information and try to get as many people at that minimum, right? I suspect it's more nuanced than that, but I don't yet know exactly how. And so then, you know, I think my instinct would be to think deeply about that question and then think about, okay, you know, how could these reasonably be combined? Or can they be, right? Maybe they can't be, maybe they're sort of inherently at odds.
One thing I've been thinking about lately, which to me sort of unifies these things, is that my position in society gives me a great deal of agency to choose whether or not I am connected, right? So I can access all the information I want, and I'm well represented if I wish to be as a consumer and so on. But for instance, because I'm not applying for public housing, the government does not know whether or not I use illegal drugs, because I haven't had any contact with any institution that has demanded to do drug testing of me or has asked me an invasive questionnaire as a condition of accessing social services. So I can avoid that flow of information while participating in all the ones that are useful to me.
Yeah, and these, you know, there are these mechanisms that I sort of mentioned briefly at the beginning that police departments are increasingly using to sort of identify gang networks. And from that, so they claim, identify other people in the community who might be part of that gang, right? And then perform surveillance on those people. And, you know, I think it should be obvious that that's going to have disproportionate effects on some communities than on others, right? You know, and I sort of wonder about that aspect, about measuring that, about understanding what the impact is of that, and the way that that impact is differential.
All right. Well, if there are no other questions, let's thank Sorelle again. And like I said, please. Santa Fe is beautiful. You'll love it.
Yeah. Thank you all. I've really appreciated the conversation.
Bye-bye. Thanks.